Zuid-Afrika's inzending voor de Oscars was een film met een anale verkrachting. Getiteld Skoonheid.
A film about a middle-aged Afrikaner who's obsessed by a young, beautiful young man.
Because the main challenge was to make a film about someone who is really affected by beauty, you know, as a poisonous element. And so the Afrikaner, repressed Afrikaner with the beautiful young man is a very big journey for a character to cross. You know, if it was a married woman or a married man who's having an affair, it's something we've seen before. But the idea of infatuation and obsession going across this even greater barrier was the main reason why I chose that milieu.
Is that how it started? You wanted to tell something like that, or?
I wanted to make a film about beauty in the sense that the dangerous element of beauty, the idea that it has a fairly potent effect on all of us. And there's always this tension between pursuing it or not pursuing it. And some people have the currency of beauty in the world where they feel very confident and they use it as a means of fostering relationships with other people. And then there are those people who feel like they have to always substantiate themselves because they don't feel like they have this beauty quality. And Francois is on one end and Christian is on the other.
Francois, the middle-aged Afrikaner.
Middle-aged Afrikaner. And so he feels like his currency in the world is who he is and how much money he has or what he's built for himself, where Christian just walks into a room and immediately has value. And Francois envies that. He lusts after it, he obsesses about it, but he also hates it because he's never had it.
Hij is weg, dat is fijn. Jammer. Maar hij is in elk geval niet meer welkom. Die tweede keer dat zoiets gebeurt. Dat is niet weer. Nu ja, toe. Kom ons drinken.
Cheers.
As we researched it, we discovered that, you know, these men, although they are sexually repressed, they don't necessarily abstain from sex with other men. They just compartmentalize it in a different part of their brain and don't identify as being gay at all.
But they do identify it as having sex, I hope, or?
They would classify themselves as men who have sex with men, and it's not seen as a lifestyle choice or a relationship choice. It's more just a physical activity. And so there are rules, no kissing on the mouth, no, you know, it's anonymous to a degree.
Because kissing would mean gay?
Well, kissing would mean intimacy. It would mean feelings. And I think that's the most important, they extract any kind of sense of feeling from the situation. That's why, in essence, it's actually quite a boring sexual experience because it's very functional.
Yeah, that's the way how you filmed it?
Yes.
In the farm?
The important thing is that it was not meant to be something that seemed appealing in any way. It almost seemed dysfunctional because you also even wonder if these men are actually physically attracted to each other, because it seems like the point is just to fulfill this very frustrating desire and to do it as quickly and as blindly as possible.
Yeah, and the moment he is attracted to someone,
that's when things start collapsing.
Was it difficult to find someone to play Francois?
We thought it would be. I mean, we saw a lot of people, but whenever they came in, obviously they had no idea what they were casting for. They were just reading one or two scenes.
So they didn't know they would have gay sex in a farm.
No. Okay. Only once we had a short list, or we had like two or three people who were very keen, and did we start talking more about what the film was about. But South African actors are very adventurous, and they're so hungry for challenging roles. I think I was very lucky because my previous film had got a lot of attention for the lead actress, and she had traveled the world and won many awards. So I kind of had the reputation already of being a director who gives you opportunities or is going to give you something really interesting to do. So it was very easy to entice actors. And once I told them what the film was about, they felt that if they had a reaction that was negative, that meant that they weren't very professional.
So the one who gets to play him is Dion Lotz?
Dion Lotz, yes.
And he didn't dare to back down after he was sort of on board.
Dion was definitely the first choice. He was the guy that I, when I saw him the second time I saw him, I was like, this is definitely the guy that I want. And he never ever flinched at the idea. He read the script, came back, loved it, was really excited. I think it's because Dion has no trouble with who he is. He doesn't feel insecure about anything that the character does. So he had no fear in playing Francois. There was nothing about Francois that frightened him, and so he never believed that anyone would ever confuse him for Francois. So he really just ran into Francois's head, and could easily run out every day. At the end of the day, he was always just Dion.
What do you think? Stop it, Bronson.
Sorry. Why me? There's no other reason why you want me to help you.
That's because I don't. I don't have anyone else with that kind of money.
Get off me! Get off me! Get off me! Quick! Ow!
Is it necessary for you as a director to keep a level of intensity?
Yes.
How do you do that? In a scene like that?
On a scene like that, it's very quiet in the set. The actors don't speak to each other during takes. They have separate dressing rooms. There's no camera people in the room. There's just the camera. So it's there alone completely. There's only one makeup artist for the day. No one else is allowed to talk to Dion except for me. You do things that keep the actors in the headspace. That worked really well for the younger actor, because I think he really started getting frightened of Dion on that day, because they just never ever were Dion and Charlie. They were always just Christian and Francois on that day. And so the more we did it, I think the harder it became for him. And at the end of the day, he actually couldn't really speak to Dion. He had to go home, and the next day they were okay again. Male rape is a very taboo subject, especially in South Africa. And I wanted to put a face on that. What does it really look like? Rape is a horrible thing. I didn't want to avoid it. I didn't want it to be the suggested scene, because nothing else had ever been suggested, especially the first sex scene in the film. So we could never just shy away from it. So we really had to to give it its full intensity. And I think that it does polarize the audience. Some people just can't recover from that scene. But that's also kind of the aspect of the film being difficult, like, because now you still have to continue with Francois after that.
De Chinese activist en kunstenaar Ai Weiwei heeft huisarrest. In Rotterdam wordt zijn werk vertoond in het Ai Weiwei Café. There are 9 million bicycles in
Beijing. Hij is beeldend kunstenaar en in die zin heeft hij vroeger, zeg maar, wat hij ook ziet als documentaires, maar dat zijn echt conceptuele kunstvideo's. Dus echt een project zoals hier loopt bijvoorbeeld, waarbij die in een gedeelte van Beijing alle straten heeft gefilmd.
Het is funny because it's this 150 hours installation running continuously, so I think it's like you have to have be like for the whole festival to watch it, yeah.
I think I prefer this film that nothing happens, nothing especially happens.
De laatste jaar heeft hij erg wat hij zelf noemt sociale documentaires gemaakt. En ik denk ook dat dat voor die Chinezen echt verbazingwekkend is. Omdat, zeg maar, als hij wordt staande gehouden door de politie, dan praat hij terug. Dat is sowieso al iets wat ze niet zo doen. Maar hij zoekt voor een deel ook de confrontatie. Zeg maar, in diezelfde film Disturbing the Peace zit een moment. Dan zien ze eigenlijk buiten een auto een tijd lang stilstaan. Er zit een man in gewone kleren in. Zij denken, ja, dat is een politiespion of wat dan ook. En dan kun je zeggen van, nou ja, goed, laten we ons daar niets van aantrekken of een beetje aan de andere kant gaan zitten. Hij loopt naar buiten, recht op die man af, doet dat raampje open en in feite stuurt hij die man gewoon weg.
Zou je me? Is het zou je me? Is het zou
je me? Is
het
zou
je me? Is
het zou je
me? Is het zou je me? Is het zou je me?
你拉不准的,你打,我把金都他。沒有,報警,報警。剛報警。報警。報警。哎,別着急。報警啊。報警。幹嘛啊?報警。哎,搞日了。我一看他們就不對,你知道嗎?
Dat heeft wel gevolgen, omdat dan in diezelfde film zie je ook dat midden in de nacht komt er dus een half leger politie dat hotel binnen om hem van zijn bed te lichten. Dus ik denk dat dat maakt dat mensen in China ook zo'n bewondering voor hem hebben. Omdat hij eigenlijk durft wat niemand anders durft.
Haak hem even pillen. Ursäkta, förlåt, det var inte meningen att göra dig rädd eller så. Vad lyssnar du på?
Musik.
Vad för slags musik?
Olika.
Pippi Långstrump.
Wat vond je ervan?
Ik vond dat allemaal wel heel erg mooi, maar veel te lang. Er heeft niemand tegen die jongen gezegd, joh, maak het iets korter.
Ik vond dat het je steeds weer op een ander been zette. En dat vond ik heel erg knap in deze film.
De film irriteert je ook heel de tijd. En dat duurt voor mij dan een beetje te lang.
De film gaat over een groepje blanke jongetjes dat op pad gaat om te winkelen, gewoon een gezellige middag te hebben. En die worden op een hele slimme manier belaagd door een groepje donkere jongens.
Dit is eigenlijk een speelfilm, maar
Tegelijkertijd lijkt het ook een documentaire.
Het kijkje in de keuken nemen bij zo'n jongerengroepje. Ik denk dat dat heel knap is geweest.
En dan krijg je een film met zo'n sterke mening, denk je. En of is het een beschouwing?
Ik weet niet of hij zozeer een boodschap heeft of dat hij de mensen heel erg ongemakkelijk wil laten voelen. Want alles in de film is ongemakkelijk.
Ik herken dat ik soms al bang word als ik in de verte donkere jongens zie lopen. Terwijl ik absoluut niet weet of er nou werkelijk reden is om bang te zijn. Dus ik vind het ook heel leerzaam.